Welcome to the God Culture, where we urge you to challenge tradition, as 1 Thessalonians 5:21 tells us, prove all things, hold fast that which is good. We do not intend to be confrontational, but to compare what the Bible really says versus the traditions of men, which Jesus himself rebuked. Jesus said to the Pharisees, "Full well ye reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your own tradition." Mark 7:9. We are continuing our Solomon's Gold series today with Not Ophir. In this segment, we will challenge many of the claims of Ophir, Sheba, and Tarshish. We have mentioned some of these along the way, but now we will lay out their case and prove them wrong. In our research, this was actually the first step, as we wanted to know if there was a possible valid claim. However, we have found that outside of the Philippines, there is little biblical, nor historical, nor geographical support for any of these areas to really be taken seriously, and we will show you why we say that. We know biblical scholars latch on to some of these, even occult-inspired myths, but they are not really following the Bible in these cases. Whenever there is a real revelation, though, we have typically watched some scholars ignorantly bear down on their position, even though it's clearly wrong. We recently watched a video about the location of the temple in the city of David, not Jerusalem, which was well supported biblically. Yet then a so-called scholar responded with a video basically quoting scholars and hardly any actual scripture. He maintained quite the attitude as he pontificated his credentials and those who he quoted and demeaned the gentleman who provided real research because he was not a scholar but a mere police investigator. Pardon us for noticing this, but wouldn't a police investigator be more credible than a blowhard scholar any day? Well, we think so. Who knows, you may see similar responses to some of our own videos at some point. If so, do as we challenge you, prove all things for yourself, as we're not perfect either. Whenever you challenge tradition, there will likely be blowback, but truth stands the test. One other quick thing, we had an email come through asking what references we used for our videos. You may have missed it, especially if you're viewing this on a cell phone, but we try to source each slide throughout the presentation, offering each reference for every slide that we present. If we've missed any, we apologize, as this project has been quite an undertaking. But we are not claiming perfection here, but are striving for excellence in our research, and we hope you find the same. Let's take a look at the first claim, which actually includes two of the largest claimants, which many scholars actually side with because they attend seminaries and travel in groups who are taught to think alike in an organizational paradigm, the land of Cush, Ethiopia, and Yemen. Just who was Cush and who was Joktan? Let's dive in. In the U.S., there is an educational channel called PBS, Public Broadcasting System, I believe. They produce children's programming as well as documentaries on history. They are supposed to be credible. In this case, they characterize a very common opinion as to the location of Sheba. However, they fail to actually provide scriptural references. They misquote the Bible, and they link the Queen of Sheba with other occult stories. And it's not an occult story at all. It's from the Bible. The story of the Queen of Sheba appears in religious texts, sacred to Jews, Christians, and Muslims, they say. Which ones? Well, they don't say, do they? Less than you think, by the way. Described in the Bible as simply a queen of the East. What? Okay, so we went back and reread the story of the Queen of Sheba in 1 Kings chapter 10, 9 and 10, as well as 2 Chronicles, and all the passages we could find. Not one time does the Bible say, at least that we can find, that the Queen of Sheba is the Queen of the East. The only time we can find where Sheba is referenced as the queen of a direction like that is in Matthew 12:42, and it's paralleled in Luke. We find a quote from Jesus himself referring to the Queen of Sheba as the Queen of the South. However, we agree, if you consider the actual story, Sheba is clearly in Ophir, and it is definitely in the east, the southeast Pacific. But this could be a simple mistake in the article. No problem. Of course, they could have remedied this by actually citing the scripture they are referencing, but they failed to do that also. Jesus also says, "She came from the uttermost parts of the earth." And here is the map again from Eratosthenes. I had to say that again. Again, that is east, but they don't cite this because it completely dispels the ridiculous notion that Ethiopia or Yemen even remotely qualify as Ophir, Sheba, or Tarshish, as far as the Bible, history, and geography are concerned anyway. Modern scholars believe she came, the Queen of Sheba, from the kingdom of Aksum in Ethiopia, the kingdom of Saba in Yemen, or both. Well, how's that for a choice? Those are great options. I guess it's settled. No, far from it. It's not settled. We'll address this further, but let's keep going in this article. Their main clue is that she brought bales of incense with her as a gift. Now that is true. Frankincense only grows in these two areas. Wait, is that what the Bible says? Frankincense? We don't remember that. 1 Kings and 2 Chronicles both say, "The Queen of Sheba came on camels that bear spices." The Hebrew word used is besem. It is a general term for spices. What are they talking about, frankincense? It doesn't say frankincense. It merely says, generically, spices. From a National Geographic documentary called The Real Queen of Sheba, as if they would know, we found the scripture they are referring to. No, it's not actually one from the actual story, and just as PBS did, they don't actually reference the original story in the Bible, but other scriptures and jump to conclusions based on that. Not exactly a scholarly move, in our opinion. They are referring to Jeremiah 6:20. "To what purpose cometh there to me frankincense from Sheba?" Uh-oh, that settles it, right? No. We'll talk about this. "And the sweet came from a far country. Your burnt offerings are not acceptable, nor your sacrifices sweet unto me." This passage does say frankincense, but the Queen of Sheba story does not. It mentions the name Sheba, but which Sheba? Do you know there are three Shebas in the Bible, and we'll cover this later in this video. Every time Sheba is mentioned, though, it does not refer to the same Sheba necessarily. But first, what is the Hebrew word for frankincense used here? Is it besem, which is used in the Queen of Sheba story both times for the word spices? Frankincense, lebona. That's not besem, is it? This is used at least 15 times in the Old Testament, and the Greek libanos is used in the New Testament. Gee, wouldn't a scholar know this? Well, it should be the first thing they research, of course. Maybe Jeremiah doesn't know when to use labona, the word frankincense, or besem, the word spices. Well, many references say Jeremiah is actually the writer of 1 Kings, meaning he wrote the Queen of Sheba story, because Chronicles is known to be a copy of the story. So the origin is 1 Kings. So if Jeremiah wrote 1 Kings, then he knew the difference between frankincense and besem, spices. Regardless, though, frankincense was a very precious spice, but it is simply not identified as such in the Queen of Sheba story. Hopping on a plane, as this guy from National Geographic did immediately after hearing with no further research at all, is just nonsense and, I guess, what they call good TV. Anyone searching for truth from an actual Bible story would certainly look at the Bible first before taking a trip. But back to our PBS article, which is just about to get interesting. Remember we told you in our Queen of Sheba Part 2 segment about the Kibra Nagast from Ethiopia? Well, they buy into this occult story, and you'll see why. It says, King Solomon has heard of Sheba and her great kingdom. He has also heard that she has a strange feature, a left foot that is cloven like that of a goat and a hairy leg. What? And some of you thought we might be making this up, I guess. Yep, these scholars actually buy into this junk. They, of course, don't even mention where this occult legend comes from in this article, but we will. Certainly not the Bible or even the Quran. We mentioned in part 2, the Queen of Sheba Revisited, that the Ethiopian Kibra Nagast is the source of the occult story that some scholars are using, in which the Queen of Sheba in Ethiopia is a goat lady. Beautiful. This would make her a hybrid creature, not fully human, and a product of the Genesis 6 fallen angel manipulation of God's creation that brought about the flood in the first place. We will go deeper into this in our upcoming flood series, which we are working on now. Oh, and then the goat lady of Sheba slept with Solomon because he just couldn't resist, I imagine. Not according to the Bible, of course. And miraculously, she birthed Solomon's child on the way home. Must have been a much longer trip than the Bible claims. Since she was not fully human, though, perhaps she conceived and bore a child in just weeks or days. But that doesn't even fit the goat pregnancy cycle, does it? No, this is just a ludicrous occult story, which ultimately justifies ruling bloodlines claiming they descend from Solomon. Oh, and that goes much higher than you think. He teaches her about his God, Yahweh. The Bible does not say she serves a different God, by the way. What an assumption. Rather despicable assumption. And she becomes a follower. This is how some Ethiopians believe Christianity came to their country. What? Okay, except this was 1000 BC and Solomon was not a Christian because this was 1000 years before Jesus Christ. Of course, the media can say just about anything by starting with the words, some say. Who is some? You and your producer and maybe the guy you met in the hallway? Beware of anything that comes after some say. So back to the claim that Ethiopia and Yemen both are the kingdom of Sheba. There are two Shebas in the Table of Nations, and also a Seba, who are being confused in the interpretation of this story. And again, scholars should certainly know better. First mentioned in the Table of Nations is Noah's son, Ham's lineage. He had a son named Cush, who is well known to be the founder of Ethiopia. Cush has a son named Seba, his first son. Remember this name. And a grandson named Sheba. There it is. So there is a Sheba in Ethiopia. We agree. However, if one looks no further than this and draws the conclusion that this is the Queen of Sheba's kingdom, they are certainly not Bible scholars at all. Even Abraham had a grandson named Sheba, so we need to be careful here. So does the actual story of the Queen of Sheba tell us which Sheba we should be looking for here? Yes, it does. But not if you cut off three verses of the story, because it actually starts in 1 Kings 9:26, not 10:1, as the nice header indicates in the King James. 1 Kings 9:26 through 10:1. And King Solomon made a navy of ships in Ezion-Geber, which is beside Eloth, on the shore of the Red Sea, not the Mediterranean Sea, in the land of Edom. And Hiram sent in the navy, his servants, shipmen that had knowledge of the sea, with the servants of Solomon. And they came to Ophir and fetched from thence gold, 420 talents, and brought it to King Solomon. And when the queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to prove him with hard questions. Where is her own land? Because in 1 Kings 10:6 later it says, "It was a true report that I heard in mine own land." Her own land is Ophir. So which Sheba are we talking about here? We're talking about Sheba, the brother of Ophir. Does this passage say Solomon's navy stopped in Ethiopia or Yemen and told their queens? Some scholars speculate that because she arrived on camels, she lived in the desert. But if she came by ship to Ezion-Geber on the Red Sea, which fits the story, she still needed to journey by land to Jerusalem, thus the great train of camels. One cannot make that assumption, but this is not just mentioned at the beginning of the story. 1 Kings 10:10 through 13, the end of the story. And she gave the king 120 talents of gold, which the queen of Sheba gave to Solomon, and the navy also of Hiram. Okay, so they're there at the same time? Yes. That brought gold from Ophir. From where? From Ophir, from Sheba, brought in from Ophir great plenty of almug trees. We prove that that is the Nara tree, the Philippine national tree, which is a Hebrew word, by the way, and precious stones. And King Solomon gave unto the queen of Sheba. So she turned and went to her own country, she and her servants. That's the end of the story, by the way, and there is no further mention until Jesus brings up the Queen of the South in prophecy later. So the Queen of Sheba heard of Solomon's wisdom and God in her own land, Ophir from Solomon's navy, who came to trade for resources. That's what the story's saying here. The queen arrives in Jerusalem at the same time that Solomon's navy arrives, and they give their gifts to Solomon, basically together. Then the queen leaves. Does it say she slept with Solomon and turned and went? No. Does it say on the return journey home she bore a child? No. So she just went probably on one of Hiram's ships to return to Sheba in the land of Ophir. We break this down in more detail in part 2, Queen of Sheba Revisited. This is obvious, yet it seems to have been misused for so long. It's maps like these that really highlight wrong thinking. Sheba, son of Joktan, did not live with Sheba, son of Cush, nor did Havilah, son of Joktan, with the son of Cush, named Havilah as well. But Ophir is the key here. There is no Ophir in the line of Cush and Ham, only in the line of Shem and Joktan. And we know where Joktan's sons went because the Bible tells us so. From Mesha, which is Meshad Iran, to Sephar, a mount of the east. We believe this to be the mountain named after Joktan's brother, Mount Pulag in the Philippines, which is a Hebrew variant of Peleg, bearing the exact definition of Peleg's purpose. It was divided because in his days, the whole earth was divided according to the Table of Nations. And let's not forget, the Bible tells us the ships of Tarshish, which go to Ophir in multiple passages, take a 3-year journey. Again, Ethiopia and Yemen were at most 3 to 4 months round-trip journey, probably less because you didn't even have to leave the Red Sea at all. The Philippines, however, would take the required 3-year journey, 1 year at sea, 1 year to plant, harvest, and trade, and 1 year back at sea, which actually fits the narrative, unlike Ethiopia and Yemen. And we showed you a reference that claims Sheba is in fact Ethiopia, which we have no problem with because it doesn't matter. That Sheba, and it is Sheba, is the grandson of Cush and ineligible for the Queen of Sheba because that's not Ophir's brother from the Far East. Of special note, this article is lumped in with 3 other occult stories. Notice them on the right. Wonder why. Now, let's talk about Yemen specifically, because Yemen is known as the land of the Sabaeans, or Saba, which is also cited in the National Geographic documentary on Sheba as well, but it is assumed that Saba is Sheba. Well, that's just not true, and we'll prove it. Even Encyclopedia Britannica says Saba, ancient Yemen, is biblical Sheba. Somehow they note that Saba is frequently mentioned in the Bible, however, but does anyone ever cite any of these scriptures in their claims? Because the Bible tells us what Saba is. Does anyone pay attention? Of course not. Not these scholars. Again, this would be the wrong Sheba anyway. But let's see what the Bible says about Saba and the Sabaeans. Did Solomon and the writer of 1 Kings know who the Sabaeans of Saba were? In Job 1, 14 and 15, "And there came a messenger unto Job and said, The oxen were plowing and the asses feeding beside them. And the Sabaeans fell upon them and took them away. Yea, they have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee." Whoa! So long before Solomon and David, Job knew who the Sabaeans were, the people of Saba. Oh, he knew all too well. They are the ones who Satan used to execute his wrath when God removed Job's hedge of protection. They are the ones who took his cattle and killed his servants. This was hundreds of years before Solomon. they encountered and traded with them beginning around 1200 BC or earlier. There is no mystery, and Solomon would have called them by their name, just as Job, Ezekiel, and Isaiah did. Is there further evidence of the Sabaeans from Saba, though? Here are two verses that really spell this out. Isaiah 43:3, "For I am the Lord thy God, the Holy One of Israel, thy Savior. I gave Egypt for thy ransom, Ethiopia and Seba for thee." Notice, just two chapters later, Isaiah says, Isaiah 45:14, "Thus saith the Lord, the labor of Egypt and merchandise of Ethiopia and of the Sabaeans, men of stature, shall come over unto thee, and they shall be thine." Could the Bible be any clearer? Egypt, Ethiopia, and Seba equals Egypt, Ethiopia, and the Sabaeans, Saba. Seba equals Sabaeans, not Sheba. It equals Saba, not Sheba. Not convinced? The International Standard Bible Encyclopedia renders Seba, again, remember, Cush's son from the Table of Nations, Sheba's uncle from Ethiopia, in that area, as Saba, Saban, and Sabaean. The Sabaeans and Saba are the area of Cush's first son, Seba, not Sheba. But here's another source. Strong's Concordance says the word Seba originates from the word Saba. So who are the Sabaeans of Saba? They are from the line of Sheba's uncle Seba. And we cannot find a Hebrew variant of Sheba that is Seba. It doesn't exist. They are not the same word nor person, which is why they are listed separately in the Table of Nations. Ready for more? Psalms 72:10, "The kings of Tarshish and of the Isles," what Isles? Ophir and Sheba, "bring presents. The kings of Sheba and Seba shall offer gifts." Okay. This is another verse used to say Sheba and Seba are the same place. But look at the whole thing. We know Tarshish and the Isles are in Ophir, and his brother is Sheba. But now there's a mention of Seba, and it confuses things. We believe that Seba, which is a variant of Saba, Yemen, is likely referring to the kingdom of Saba. We haven't mentioned this yet, though, but there is a Saba, which is a disputed area of the Philippines in Southeast Asia. It doesn't matter, though, for the purposes of this video, because if it's the one in Ethiopia, it's the wrong Sheba for the queen anyway. Even traditional genealogies of Yemen show Saba isn't even the biblical Saba, no, showing it was named for yet another Saba. And they further confuse this by saying maybe not even that Saba, but another Saba. Would the real Saba please stand up? And scholars treat this as an open and shut case. Saba is Sheba? Bull. Saba is Seba, not Sheba. Search the internet long enough, and you will find all kinds of gold mine discoveries in Africa, Saudi Arabia, and Yemen. None of them will show you a date in which they existed, because you can't date gold nor most rock without some other marker, which will be difficult to find in a gold mine. They will release what looks like a press release announcing the great archaeological find, but they will fail to prove anything because they are looking in the wrong place. And where in the Bible does it say there were gold mines in this story? Yes, there's gold, and it came from somewhere. However, the Philippines had gold near the surface, according to the king of Butuan, and it did not require digging deep into the mountain with major excavation equipment. Here's one that was sent to us from one of our viewers, and we appreciate it. Ophir. It seems Sharm el-Sheikh in Sinai used to be called Ophir, and now there is a strait next to it still referenced by the name Ophir. Ophir equals Ophir? Could be, right? Except the definition of Ophir is towards Ophir, meaning you're not there yet, because Solomon's navy passed by Ophir towards Ophir. Also, we came across a copyrighted video we cannot show you, which asserts that Africa was Ophir because the word Africa comes from the word Ophir. If this is true, then Africa means towards Ophir. Not that it is Ophir. Why make a claim without understanding the root word in the first place? We keep coming across references as well that the Quran supports that the Queen of Sheba is from Ethiopia or Yemen, and Yemen, either way, and even gives their names. But this is more disinformation. Here's the passage in the Quran where a queen of Saba, which is Seba, the Sabaeans, is referenced, but not the queen of Sheba. We cannot find this in the Quran, nor any reference to a name for this queen of Saba either. We know Solomon knew the Sabaeans, and they were referenced way back in the times of Job even. So we do not doubt he may have met their queen at some point. But that's not Sheba, brother of Ophir from the Far East, which is the right queen of Sheba. But let us not forget that Islam was not even founded until the 7th century CE. That's 1700 years after the queen of Sheba. This website goes on to say, the people of Sheba, or the Sabaeans, as they were called, by whom? No, they were not called the people of Sheba, the Sabaeans. That's not what it says. And then later it says the kingdom of Sheba, i.e. Saba. No, it was not Saba. Sheba and Saba are not the same word. Seba is from the word Saba, not Sheba. This is conjecture way after the fact. Way after the fact. To try to stretch a justification that's just not there. They illustrate from the very Quran that this is the queen of Saba and try to make the connection, but no evidence for the association of Saba and Sheba is referenced. It is assumed, and that is not scholarship. Some scholars were really reaching into thin air and pulling this one out. They claim Ophir is the Indus Valley people in India. Problem is, the Indus Valley civilization fell apart 700 years before Solomon. So why would they even mention such a, stupid idea? In order to counter the Spanish find of Ophir in the Philippines, the British named the mountain Ophir in 1801. Even the Malays refer to the mountain as Gunung Ledang, and always have, and not Ophir. They never adopted that name. There is no coherent claim of Malaysia, Indonesia, Australia, or any of the other Pacific islands as being the location of Ophir, not even the Solomon Islands. So let's deal with Tarshish. One of our viewers sent us a video claiming Gadara, Spain was Tarshish. Thank you for that, by the way. Wikipedia suggests it may have been Tartessus, Spain. Both in Spain. Really? Did someone forget to tell this to the King of Spain who hired explorer Sebastian Cabot to find a west route to the far east to Ophir and Tarshish, which is in writing in the actual contract? We mentioned this before in our history series. No, Spain is in the wrong direction. The only scripture that scholars use to justify this one is the story of Jonah, but they fail to read all the rest of the Tarshish scriptures, that is, Ophir, Orient, East, 3 years' journey, the Isles afar off, beyond the sea. They also fail to realize that the Red Sea port was broken up in the days of Jehoshaphat, just before Jonah, so the Red Sea was no longer an option to go to Ophir. And Jonah was running from God, not looking for the shortest route, but more so, the longest. We cover this in detail in our Jonah's Journey Corrected Part 3 video. Do you see any legitimate claims to Ophir, Sheba, or Tarshish here? We do not. We see desperate attempts to cover up the real history of the Philippines, which is a perfect match for these areas in every respect we have researched. Again, we have drawn our conclusion that Philippines is Ophir, Sheba, and Tarshish, and even ancient Havila, with overwhelming evidence from the Bible, history, geography, Hebrew names, etc. Now for our final video in the series, Part 9, Prophecy of the Future Philippines. If modern prophecy scares you, though, don't worry. For this segment, we are not going to prophesy our words to you, but we are going to point you to scriptures where Jesus and the prophets literally prophesy about the future of Ophir, Sheba, Tarshish, the Philippines. They are speaking to you, Philippines, Ophir, Sheba, Tarshish. Frankly, this is the real point of this whole series. Now that you have absorbed all of this, we will challenge you to become what the Bible says you will become. We believe the Philippines is rising. Thank you for watching our Solomon's Gold series. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel and view our website at thegodculture.com. Always remember to prove all things for yourself.